I was supposed to be there with my teams, but at the end, for different reasons, I was not able to go back again to Gaza. But I follow closely the operations. In a way, the team I know was kind of happy because we were terminating a successful mission of receiving another hundreds of tons on the second time we came by boat, which was very important for us because we had to be increasing the amount of food coming so we could be reaching from the middle of Gaza all the people in the north. And the team was coming from dropping in a warehouse we had south of Gaza in Dar es Salaam, all the food they were able to download before it got too dark. We were in an area that is kind of a secure area, what they call a deconflicting area, and was two armored cars plus one soft shell. And the teams were, as far as we know, already coming back from the warehouse in a way. And is when seems is when first I found out is that we couldn't get in touch with the teams, that somehow we kind of lost communication. You could argue that sometimes cell signal doesn't work well all the time in Gaza, and you will say that that was something like has happened before. You want to more or less have always the security that the people are leaving the place at the hour they are telling you, and they are getting to the next point at the hour they are telling you, as a way to keep the security. But then obviously we began seeing use this information that something went wrong, that something happened. And then is when I found out that our teams were target. And then obviously we found out that was beyond being target, that was members that died. We then had all the information, obviously, in the first minutes and hours, but very clear. The situation began being very obvious when we began seeing images of these bodies and these passports in the hospital that confirmed these were our people. At the end is what we know, what everybody knows, that 17 members between the specialty security people we have, three British individuals and three international crew plus one Palestinian, that they were target systematically, car by car. They attacked the first car. We're still trying to get all the information on what happened on the first car. We have a feeling they were able to escape safely because it was an armored vehicle. This was only the third day we had armored vehicles. Within 6 months trying to bring them in. But the first armored vehicle was hit. They were able to seems escape. We still don't know all the details on the events in terms of people injured or people even dead. They were able to move in the second one. Again, this one was hit. They were able to move in the third one. In the process, we know they were trying to call. But in the chaos of the moment, whatever happened, they to try to be telling IDF that what are they doing? That they were targeting us in a conflicting zone, in an area controlled by IDF. Them knowing that was our teams moving on that route with two armor, with three cars. And then they hit the third one, and then we saw the consequences of that continuous targeting attack. Seven people dead. But there are seven on top of a list of more than another 190 humanitarian workers that they've been killed over the last 6 months. Some information from some other people we are getting, even seems was not used three, but were few others that they miss. But still, I cannot confirm that it was used three individual targets or was few other ones that because they were not successful in hitting, they keep trying. This happened over more than 1.5, 1.8 kilometers. So this was not just a bad luck situation where, oops, we dropped the bomb in the wrong place or no. This was over 1.5, 1.8 kilometers with a very defined humanitarian convoy that had signs in the top, in the roof, a very colorful logo that we are obviously very proud of, but that's very clear who we are and what we do.
Israel and the United States have said that the attacks were not deliberate. Do you accept that?
Well, totally. Initially, I would say categorically no. Obviously, IDF and the Israeli government are doing their own investigation, but I do believe everybody, every country, obviously, that nationals, including the United States, that had nationals that die on this attack, we need to have an investigation that is neutral from retired military, from retired judges, where the true nature of the events must be known by all parties, especially for the families of the grieving families of the people that die, for obviously not only World Central Kitchen, but every humanitarian organization, and at the end, to say every single human being, humanitarians and civilians should never be paying the consequences of war. This is a basic principle of humanity. At the time, this looks like it's not a war against terrorism anymore. Seems this is a war against humanity itself. You cannot be destroying every building. You cannot be destroying every hospital, every school. You cannot be targeting humanitarian. You cannot be targeting children. You cannot be fighting the basis of what humanity should be standing for. Even if we were not in coordination with the IDF, not democratic country and not military can be targeting civilians and humanitarians, especially when the technology today allows you to know things in ways not too long ago was not possible. Those drones have eyes on everything that moves in Gaza. I've been there. This is drones non-stop flying above you. It's nothing that moves that IDF doesn't know. But said that, even nobody should be targeting ever humanitarian organizations and civilians continuously. I will say that yes, IDF knew of our movements, COGAT, the humanitarian branch, which they've been working very, very hard to try to bring more food into Gaza, even I would say, not successfully enough. CLA, the conflicting was clear, the route was clear, the communication was clear. Obviously, this is a very hard situation for everybody, but we need to know the truth. We own it to the people. We own it to some of them who were friends and people I served with in the front. We own it to the Palestinians that they died before them, to every single other humanitarian organization and every other humanitarian. We own it to every children that has died under circumstances that should not be happening. I repeat again, this cannot look anymore like it's a war against humanity itself. I will tell to Prime Minister Netanyahu, 200 humanitarians have died already. Tens of thousands of civilians have died. I'm so sorry, but I think one humanitarian life is one too many. One children is one too many. Anything above that, I will not say is what happens in war. We should be looking for the humanity we all have within. I think you know what is really amazing? World Central Kitchen was there feeding people in Israel day one after the brutal attack. We did millions of meals, feeding hospitals, feeding kibbutz, feeding people that were displaced inside Israel. Why? Because World Central Kitchen stands for humanity. It's there next to the people, not the color of their skin or their religion. We are always next to people. That's who we are. Feeding people is a sign of strength, not a sign of weakness. And if anybody knows that, will be Prime Minister Netanyahu and the Israeli people. To feed the strangers, especially in times of Passover. I think this is one of the lessons of Passover. You will feed the strangers because other strangers feed you before. And that is something that should be protected and in a way cherished and celebrated. So this is what I will tell President Netanyahu. How it is possible that seems this war is waged to save Israeli hostages, some of them of different nationalities, children that they are somewhere in Gaza, and that they have the right to be free and liberated. But how are you going to be given an opportunity for them to be free and safe when they may be dying under the rubble of the same weapons Israel is using to wage this war? Weapons that at the times they've been provided by America itself. Sure, humanitarian aid needs to be increased yesterday. He only has to pick up the phone and allow the humanitarian aid to start flowing. It's plenty of opportunities that we can feed everybody. Plenty of opportunities we can bring medication to everybody. Plenty of opportunities to make sure that we don't keep killing everything that moves inside Gaza. I repeat again, this is a war against humanity itself. And you can never win that war because humanity eventually will always prevail. I spoke to President Biden yesterday. President Biden made a statement, which seems is already a harder stand, but it's very complicated to understand that we are going to be sending, America is going to be sending its Navy and its military to do humanitarian work, when at the same time, weapons provided by America, not to defend Israel itself from missile attacks, but use weapons that are killing civilians in this moment. I would say any person, or logic, pragmatic, Israelis or Palestinians, will say that what is good for me must be good for others. And at this moment, doesn't seem that way. I think the best and only way forward to have hope of a peace deal that can at least allow the parties to start talking. I will not say will we just keep bombing every single person that moves inside Gaza, killing every single children. And if you're not killing them by bombs, you are starving them by lack of food. I will never imagine that Hunger Games will be a movie. And it seems that what is happening inside Gaza is like a true Hunger Games. This has to end. And this can end only with one phone call, one person alone. The ceasefire that can allow the opportunity to no more hostages die. The ceasefire that will give the opportunity to children to feel once and for all, to sleep one night feeling they are safe. To allow trucks to arrive to every corner of Gaza so people are not dying for lack of food or lack of very basic medicines. The famine is real. The famine is real. War is complicated. The situation in Gaza is complicated. Are people selling food for $20, $30 a pound? People have no money. But war, we know, sometimes brings greediness in the best of us sometimes. But there still is not enough food. And the people that have some food, maybe they are trying to do business on it. Humanity is a complicated, complicated animal species. But the truth is that there is people that could be getting food. We have 68 kitchens. We've done 350,000 meals a day for the last many weeks. We've reached 42 million meals. We put more than 1,500 trucks inside Gaza. We have right now another 300 trucks between Cairo and Rafah. We have a warehouse operation in Jordan when we are allowed to access from Jordan. We have the airdrops we've been doing to try to reach the north that obviously has caused problems and unfortunately death. But people are dying too when convoys go by road. Sometimes people die under the tires of those convoys for different reasons, or they've been shot in the process of use trying to get a little bag of flour. Life should not be so complicated. Life should not be such a terrible situation. We are seeing one of the worst moments of humanity.
Will World Central Kitchen start its operations again?
The executive team of World Central Kitchen, I know they are meeting every day. And obviously right now, the most important is the safety of everybody, the safety of our teams. But we have a big team. We have obviously the World Central Kitchen people that came from the outside, different nationalities, which right now they are away in the outside Palestine. But we have directly 400 Palestinian members that work with us, that they are inside Palestine. And we have in total more than 3,000 people that directly, indirectly work with us in the 68 kitchens and the distribution system we have inside Gaza. We need to go every day. until we assess what really is the situation and how we can obviously try to keep going on operations. But at this point, the situation is halted. But again, we are trying to go hour by hour, analyzing the situation and how to keep doing the work we do, the work World Central Kitchen does, in places like Ukraine, obviously now in places like Gaza, in places like Lebanon, in places like Armenia. But most and foremost, we need to feel, all of us, we need to feel safe. I think America has to do more to tell, to send Israel a very clear message. America can stand next to Israel, can stand next to the right of Israel to defend its borders and to defend itself. But I don't think America and the world can be supporting Israel and just killing civilians or leaving them hungry. I think this is a fight for humanity, and this is a fight we all must win on behalf of the people that are suffering right now, on behalf of the hostages that they are suffering right now.